Great. Thank you, Scott. I'd like to welcome you all here. Came from kind of a cold and dreary Atlanta this yesterday, and it's nice to have a warm weather welcome. I want to welcome all of you here. It seems like everybody is involved with multiple systems, not just HPUX, but multiple systems and technology. So I want to cover as much as I can. A lot of what I've learned in terms of system administration is coming over from years of making the same mistakes over and over again. And I said, you know what, computers ought to work for people, not the other way around. So it's my philosophy in kind of handing things out. One of the things I'm going to do today is I'm going to interact with everybody. I want to have questions asked and answer questions, and I have a little section over here, kind of a best questions section, and when we get a best question, I'm going to put a name up there, and we have substantial prizes to offer during our seminar today. The only things I'm going to be talking about is how to make systems work for you, not the other way around. And the way I'm going to do this is that we're going to talk about how to retrofit your systems or get them started for the first time. There are a lot of things wrong with the system as it comes out of the box. You've probably noticed that because every time you put a new system, whether it's Linux or AIX or HPUX, you have to make changes. And one of the things to do is to standardize across all the systems so they look pretty much the same. And then those things that make the systems unique are outside of the normal changes. We need to change something such as the profile as you log in. We change one profile and it does not affect the unique features that are part of that system. We'll be talking about how to manage sysadmins. How many people have to work with other sysadmins on the same system? Okay, so some of you are lucky enough to be your own sysadmin, but then you have to make sure you don't make any mistakes. But we're going to talk about how to have sysadmins work together and properly share responsibilities without falling all over each other. Disk-based management, it seems that no matter how much disk you add to a system, we fill it up and exceed that capacity. That's just a given. I have terabytes of space, now I need bytes of space. So we're going to talk a little bit about basic system administration for the volume group 00, VG00, which is the OS, and how to take a look at where are the space hogs, where are they stored at, how do you find them. We have a lot of log files available in HPUX, huge number, and one of the issues is how do I look at them. What can I do about them? How can I log the information I need? How can I separate out pieces of information that are mostly noise, but I still have to keep them? A lot of you are involved with secure systems where auditors are taking a look at the results. They want to see the logs. They want to see the records from some period of time back. And so you have to figure out a way of managing that space and still meeting the needs of the auditors. So we'll talk about some of those techniques. Also talk about security, and security really comes in two forms. One of them is simply keeping the data secure, that those only authorized people have access to it. But the other is keeping the command secure so system admins don't say the awful word, oops. Because when you say oops, it's like, I didn't want to type that command. You know, Unix has also often been told as being unfriendly. Actually, it's not. It's indifferent. It just doesn't care. You type what you want to do, and it will do it for you. And if it doesn't have any error conditions, it doesn't say anything. It says, okay, I did it. Well, I didn't really want to remove all of those files. You know, that's not a good thing. So we'll talk a little bit about how to secure the system to prevent these kinds of things, to make it more difficult to make those oops mistakes. And then we'll talk about some scripting. How many people have written scripts of any sort? Any of the different languages. Okay, so it's a pretty common thing to do, and what it really is a whole series of instructions that you would type by hand, but you just simply get tired of it, or you want to loop around and around, or you want to take care of numerous things at the same time. Well, the best thing to do is to write a script and let the computer do the work for you. So let's talk about these four areas. Profiles, which is a standardized way of logging in. And we'll talk a bit about time zones. I arrived here in Arizona to find out that mountain time is not exactly mountain time. It depends on which state I'm in. So daylight savings time doesn't apply. We'll talk about shells and what kinds of shells are out there that are available for HPUX, as well as the security systems, standard, trusted, and shadow systems. So I like to have a standard template. I have, by the way, does everybody have one of these discs inside their notebook? I want to make sure everybody's got one of them. Yours may not be green. It might be white or pink or blue. The standard profiles I have in there, on that particular CD, are ones that you can put on any system, and it has sections in there, it's a fairly small one, that call other profiles. That is, they call others sourcing other types of setups, such as aliases, such as the terminal setup, very important. Things like, that are unique. For instance, some of you are running Oracle, you need to source an Oracle routine. So you'll call a local setup routine to do that. This allows the profile to stand alone on its own, and then you customize those things that are unique to the system itself. We'll talk a little bit about what we want to set, so the things about traps and UMask, set minus U and path. These are all things that you'll be encountering or have encountered already and find that you have to go back and either fix things because of that. One of the things that the profiles have, and this is really important to note, is that the profile is going to be run anytime something logs in. Now normally it's a person, they log in and they're interacting with a keyboard and everything's working normally. Well, it turns out that you might want to also do an SH and or an SU over to a user like Oracle or Sybase or Informix, and you want to actually use that environment. And that environment is going to be used in a batch mode to start up a process, to shut down a process, to do something from cron. If you log in, you go through the normal login process, you won't have a TTY device. Anybody know what a TTY is? Teletype. Anybody ever heard of a teletype? Wow. Okay, need to go to the computer museum. Teletype is where Unix started. That was the console, an actual paper device, okay, that teletype. And a teletype device has remained within the Unix environment. Well, one of the things you want to do is you want to see if I'm logging in, do I have a teletype or a terminal associated with this session? It's normal when you log in, but it's not normal in cron. It's not normal in batch. It's not normal if it's part of a knit tab. So you need to protect commands that are part of profile from having execution. Have you ever seen the message in syslog that says not a typewriter? Does that sound familiar? Yeah, not a typewriter. And that comes from these commands such as STTY. Set terminal characteristics. When you set the terminal characteristics, it assumes that you got a real terminal. Now this is a fake one. This looks like a terminal, but it's really a PC, and it's running a cheap imitation of terminal software. But that is still a terminal, has a keyboard and a display. So we need to protect that. In HBUX, there's a nice little command called TTY, and TTY simply returns back a value of 0 or 1, whether it is interactive, that is, it's a real terminal, or it's not. So what we can do is, inside profile, we can say if TTY minus S. If true, then we can go ahead and use these types of commands, and they will work just fine with no error messages. If not, you skip these commands because they're not necessary in an interactive and non-interactive environment. Also, we can do in our profile, we can do some login controls. We can actually test this user is not allowed to log in except Monday through Friday, 8 to 5. So you can make controls in there, place them into profile. We want to also set manpath and the timeout value. Manpath is where all the man pages are located. Now one would think, well, that's in user share and that's where they should be. Well, they should be, but unfortunately they get scattered all over. So as you continue to install additional software or additional products, you may have to expand manpath. So when you say man, you'll actually find the location of the man page you're looking for. And then, of course, the application-specific settings. That's where these settings for like Oracle and Informix would be. Once we're all done, we source our application settings. That's at the bottom of Etsy Profile. And by the way, we're going to be talking about Etsy Profile and Dot Profile. We're going to talk a little bit about Bash. We will mention C Shell, the evil C Shell, just for a little bit, just to let you know that it's probably not the thing that you want to use in the sysadmin world. and talked a little bit about temp and tempter. These are two variables that are commonly used in older software. If you pull some software out of an archive, you may find that the variable temp or tempter has been defined, and it's where you want to have temporary files stored. So we set those variables equal to the appropriate directory. In HPUX and most Sys5 version 4 systems, slash temp is inappropriate for temporary files. It's var temp. Everybody heard of var temp? /var/temp is the location that you should have for all of your applications and local users and local activities. Temp is technically reserved for the system and system utilities such as VI. It also is often much smaller than /var because var contains a bunch of other things such as mail and spool and so on. And most important, we want to turn the traps back on. Years ago, when I was first looking at a profile, and I saw this trap at the top of the profile, and I saw another trap at the bottom, I thought that was just an extra line, so I deleted it. Well, it turns out that the two trap statements are slightly different. The one at the top of Etsy profile looks something like this. It says trap, and then nothing, just two double quotes, and then 1, 2, and 3. And then down at the bottom of profile, here's another trap, and it says 1, 2, 3. So I says, that looks pretty much the same. Since it looks the same, this must be redundant, so I'll just take this out. Okay. Well, this statement here says, do nothing in case we get a kill signal due to a hangup, or we get a kill minus 2, or we get a kill minus 3, which is a core dump request. Those types of kill signals are things that we don't want to have happen while we're running profile. If we do that, there's a possibility that we'll bypass steps inside profile that are not part of our security system, so we don't want to do that. So that's the reason we disable them by doing nothing. This is the action. This statement here says there's no action, so go back to default. Okay, so far doesn't seem like a very innocuous kind of problem, except for this one right here, which happens to be, it's called signal hangup, H-U-P. That particular signal is sent whenever you disconnect a session. If some of you older folks remember modems, you know, that's way years and years ago. Modem would disconnect. And if it disconnected, what are we going to do? The session is running, but we've got to change it. Well, the only way we can change that condition is we have to send a signal, and that's the hangup signal. Now, this also occurs in Telnet, also occurs in SSH, any of the other connections. Sends a hangup signal to the processes that are currently attached to this TTY device. So if we send a signal 1 to a process, the process is going to say, ah, I'm not connected anymore, I'm going to shut down normally. It's like a nice, clean, normal way to shut down. If I do not re-enable that hangup, everything will work fine as long as you exit out of each session. Now, I'm sure you don't have any users that do this, but they'll log on to your system and then they'll just turn the PC off and go home. Oh, they didn't log out? No, I hit the little red X, that X up in the upper right-hand corner. Well, that's a way of shutting down without shutting down. We simply remove the connection. The TTY session is hanging, and all the processors are not receiving a hang-up signal because we're doing nothing. It's being sent to it, but it's being ignored because the trap system within the shell is just ignoring it. Not a good idea. So remember, that is going to turn traps back on, which is very important. Now, the term variable is a major issue for people who are trying different types of terminal emulators. Within HPUX, there are hundreds and hundreds of terminal emulators available. And the way this works is that the emulator is defined with a thing called term info database. It's related to curses. Curses is a little tool, a little library you can use, where you don't have to know how to clear the screen. You don't need to know the escape sequences. Instead, you call a routine called tput, which simply says, go and return back the appropriate code to do a terminal reset, or to do a terminal clear, or to go inverse video, or underline, or blink, or home up. Any of those particular capabilities are available by using tput. But it all depends on having the term variable set. Now, you've probably seen places where they'll just simply set term equals VT100. If you've worked with HPUX for a while, you'll know that there is an HP terminal. Smart Terminal's been around for about 30 years. Really great, great product. Unfortunately, it has no relationship at all to the way that a BT100 works. Of course, it also has no relationship to a WISE 50 or 60. These are completely different terminal emulations. The escape sequences are very different. So if I were to hard code term equals VT100, then hook up my HP terminal, I just get garbage characters all the time, especially in menu situations. I type in the word clear and I just get some garbage characters. It wouldn't clear the screen. I can't lie to it. You know, Unix is indifferent. It just does what you told it to do. So you told it I'm VT100, but that's not really true. So turns out also, within HPUX, the section at the top of profile has a section that says term is equal to nothing, then go ahead and do this archaic code down here. Okay? Turns out that Telnet has a subcode that brings in the terminal from the remote system. If you're on a Linux system, it brings in the code from Linux. And it doesn't say VT100 very often. It often says that the terminal type is Linux. Linux, I don't remember seeing I could buy a terminal called Linux. And the reason is because it's not really a terminal standard. It's what is set over by the Telnet protocol. So it essentially says, when you come into profile, term is set. Therefore, I'm not going to do anything about it. And you end up with a bad terminal setting. So to fix that, the easy way out is terminal equals VT100. That works for you, but it doesn't work for them because they're using CRT, and you're using reflection for Windows, and so on. So each one has a different issue. Well, it turns out that HPUX has this really cool tool called TTY type, and will actually go out and identify the type of terminal that you have. Let's take a look at one of these and see what it looks like here. And what I did is I did a, let me scroll that up a little bit so we can see it. And we'll just zoom right in. So what we did is we said TTY type minus S. Now, what you didn't see here very quickly were a couple of little flashes of special characters on the screen. What TTY type does is it goes out and says, are you a WISE 50 or a WISE anything? And gives it 1 second to answer back. If nothing happens, then it goes out and says, are you a VT100? Yes or no. Or some similar in that family, like an ANSI terminal. Yes or no. And then finally, it asks whether you're an HP terminal. Asks it in that particular order because the other orders will confuse each other. They actually cause things to happen. So it figures out that this is the type of terminal. And then it will say, well, are you a VT100, a VT220, a VT500, and so on. And then it'll figure out the number of lines and columns. And as you see, this is almost like a shell script. It put out the information. That's what the minus S does over there in the corner. It says, let's show that information in the format for a shell script. Well, then we can evaluate that, do an eval, and that's what we have on this slide here. We do an eval of the results. There's TTY type minus S, and we're going to eval that, and we'll set it so that it matches our terminal that we're typing on here. So in all your profiles, one of the first things you want to do is get rid of these term equals 100, VT100, term equals HP, term equals WISE, whatever you've got, and instead substitute this command, which will automatically set it. So the folks that log in from Australia or from Nevada or from some other location, they need to come in and they've got whatever on their PC, or they're coming in indirectly from another system, you will have the terminal type set correctly. This will also protect it. This is where you put in the TTY minus S. We're simply saying, if you have an interactive session, go ahead and do these kinds of things. These are the types of commands that are going to be affected. There's another thing that you can do also in your profile. Inside this TTY type minus S, if you have an interactive terminal, then you can do a reset. What this will do is eliminate problems with terminals that have been corrupted because you said, I want to cat this file out there called vmunix, or I want to cat some binary file. Well, the binary file is just random sets of characters. Those characters, as they come across, some of them are going to be in a combination that'll cause the terminal to do something strange. So being a smart terminal is sometimes not the best thing. The other is this RMLN, which is to remove the line of IDs at the bottom, the F1, F2, F3 keys, those little identifiers. HP terminals are especially prone to this because the default when you turn them on is it'll have a big square down there. And if you leave them on for days and weeks and months at a time, eventually it burns into the screen. So what this does is it simply goes in when you log in and turns off those IDs because people don't know how to turn them off. So this is a typical way of setting it up. We'll say if TTY minus S, we'll then do our eval. Now we've got it set up. This is correct. Then we do a set STTY. This STTY value is going to set the values that we need for specific characters, okay, for control characters. I do a reset, I'll put in the message of the day. And here's a nice thing, you've probably gotten tired of reading all the copyright messages. There's copyright by the Regents of Denver and the Regents of Washington and all sorts of things. Turns out that the copyright only needs to be presented when the system boots up. That is, when you actually boot up one time and it presents itself on the console. For everyone else, you can simply say a one-liner like this that says, if you really want to read this, I don't put that in there, but if you really want to read it, do this command, and then you'll get the copyright message. Saves an awful lot of information logged into syslog and so on. Now, I always have set minus u in my scripts. Set minus u is not the default for shells such as the POSIX shell or the K shell or bash. Set minus u says that a variable which is not defined, if it's ever used on the right-hand side of an equal sign, if it's ever used to say, tell me what the value is, it'll stop and say, you got an error. You never define the variable. The default, which is set plus u, is, hey, we're very friendly here. I'll take whatever it is, and I'll just pretend it's nothing, and I'll simply insert a nothing. Well, I worked in the response center for many years, and one of the things I did is I collected information about all the test systems that we had, about 300 of them. And I had a script that would go out there and gather that information every night. It would pull it down, run the script, and send the information back to Atlanta so we could present it to everybody so they could all find out where the latest tape drives, the latest storage was, and so on. Great idea. At one time, I had created a number of scripts in user contrib bin, or actually user local bin. I put them in user local bin. But HPOX has a history of having user local permissions being 777. That's a bad thing. Because 777, and we'll talk about this later, means that anyone can change the contents or remove files inside the directory. That's not very safe. So I put these nice little scripts in here. I'm going to have to move them from there over to user contrib bin because that one's nice and has right permissions and so on. So all these different versions of the HPOX system would be correct. Well, my script was written in such a way that I said, go ahead and transfer the files. And then once they were all transferred and I did a count to make sure they were all there, then I said, I want to RM those files. And I used a variable when I said RM. And I said rm slash var slash user slash local slash and then the variable name. Turns out that I misspelled my variable name. And so it supplied it with nothing. So I said rm minus r and then slash user slash local. Everything was gone. User local bin, user local etsy, user local man, everything was gone. 300 systems overnight. Not a good situation. That's a big oops. So I had to apologize to everybody. I said, now, not all is lost. Because I was so thoughtful to make a copy of all these files, the information that was on there, I can send you a listing of what you lost. Nobody took me up on that offer. I mean, you could go to your backup system. These are test systems. We don't make backups of them. We reload them constantly. So, well, okay, you'll need to reload those systems again. Set minus u on every script, no matter what. That way you will not have a problem. We'll talk a little bit towards the end of the seminar about how to handle unset variables when you have this. You can still reference and say, is it really set or is it not set, and not get an error. We talked about trap. UMASK 022. UMASK is not set by default when you come out of the box. And if it's not set, you have the worst possible permissions. UMASK equals zero, which means that all your files will be 666, all your directories will be 777. That's a bad thing. It's especially terrible for root, because root is going to be creating things that can be destroyed by any user on the system. Not a good situation. So minimum 022 for users. I also like to have 077 for root. That means that root cannot, it's going to create a file that cannot be touched by anyone else. Can't be read, can't be written, no execute capability at all. Now, if a user needs to read the file, I'll then make the change as the root user. I have to make a conscious decision to do that. If I don't make that decision, I've given away free permissions, and that's not a good idea in secure systems. We talked about the temp and temp dir variables, set those. Here's a cool thing we can do, and this is with the latest version of K-shell on HPUX. It's always been true with the POSIX shell that's out there, and I believe Bash had it also. Bash, by the way, is not available on HPUX by default. You have to download it from our open source information. But this allows you to eliminate that endless job of searching for core files. You know, you probably have never seen a core file dropping everywhere, unless you have some bad software, and then you have lots of core files. They fill up huge amounts of space. You'll do a find slash, and you'll be looking for these core files endlessly and endlessly. And so one of the things we want to do is to make sure we've got a way of eliminating them. Well, this is the way to do it. Ulimit minus C0 will eliminate all core files for this environment. So when I log in, if I have a crash, the core file is not saved. Okay. If I put in the S, this is nice for developers. This allows the developer to go ahead and increase Ulimit. I can now make it larger. So therefore, I'll give everybody this value, and then the developer simply puts into their local profile the ability to increase it. We also do the login control. We do that as necessary. Well, I talked a little bit about STTY. We need to make sure that IXOff is in your STTY value. Okay? That STTY value, if it does not have it, you'll find a problem when you're pasting large amounts of text. You'll paste it into VI, and you'll lose half of it. When you lose it, it's because you're sending it too fast for the remote system to accept it. Remember, the remote system may be running at 10 megabits or even 100 megabits, maybe even gigabit, but depending on the links and everything it has to go through, especially over the internet, you may not be able to keep up. If you can't keep up, the system says, I want you to X off, that is, stop transmission. If you do, everything is cool. If not, what will happen is you will lose data. And then we also mentioned the changing the copyright message. And we definitely want to change the copyright message, so we just have that one-liner, and that's basically it. We've got profiles that are sitting in the home directory. .profile is the default for a Bash or a K-shell or a POSIX shell. The original files for all of your systems, when you first get them set up, is going to be located in user new config. This is your safety net. For those of you who are golfers, this is kind of like one of those golfer special. Oh yeah, I can buy one of these and I'll be able to go back and get the information. So you can find the original one. So if you mess it up, you can always go back and pick it up. I like to have a single profile for all. And what I'll do is I'll first make sure whether I'm root or not. Okay, this is a quick way of doing that. By the way, how many people have used Grave Accents to represent the results of output of a file? Does that sound familiar? Oh, good, because it's a bad technique. What we have here is an ID command. ID minus U is going to return back a number, and that number is going to indicate zero if you're root and non-zero if you're not root. I put it in dollar parentheses because this allows you to, first off, not confuse Grave Accents, which are reverse apostrophes, with regular apostrophes. It also can be nested. The parentheses allows you to send the output of one command into the input of another command into the input of another command, so you can nest it. So this is the preferred way of testing that. So I'm saying if this equals zero, then we're going to set our umask, and we're going to set the path, and we'll throw some things in there that are only for root. User sbin and user lbin are only for root, so we'll add that. But for an ordinary user, we'll go ahead and have home bin and user bin, and that's it. I like to have a certain amount of enhancements, again, because the terminals have the capability of displaying blink and inverse video and so on. I like to have certain features displayed. And what this does, this is a sample of what you do with tput. Once your term variable is set up here someplace, then these will return back the proper things to do those particular features. And what I can do is, in this case here, we have this long echo. I've got a little test program that will demonstrate that a little faster called TTY Enhance. That's on your CD there. Again, you see it going out there and invoking what kind of a terminal. And it says, OK, this is what it is. Here's the columns. Here's the lines. And it shows you what they're going to look like. Now, those colors are part of the terminal emulator. They're not a part of what you might think would be a Linux enhancement or an AIX method of handling it. It simply says that inside my terminal emulator, which is PuTTY, in this case I'm using PuTTY, I said, if I have a blink enhancement, then what I want to do is do an inverse video, and I'm going to have the background equal to orange and the foreground equal to white. And then I have a half bright in this case, we're going to inverse it and use just the white background. So we have that capability. These are the terminal descriptions that most people talk about. These are the actual cap name, and if you look at the man page for term info, it will tell you this name here. So I said TPUT SGR0, which is normal, and then TPUT bold, and then TPUT dim, and so on. And so it shows you what the enhancements are going to look like. In some cases, we have combinations that produce different results. Now in PuTTY, it doesn't have nearly the capabilities that a terminal emulator such as WRQ has. We can go to here. The reflection terminals are HP terminals, and they have a lot more features available. We'll log in with this one here. Sorry about that, it's 132 characters wide. But when we do an enhance at this point, see it goes out and identifies who it is, and let's zoom in and look at that. So we see, oh, he's set up for a VT100, but it has more controls over the features. Okay, so if we had an HP terminal, if we had a VT100 terminal, it has more features and the combinations are set up accordingly. So you have the ability to do colorization or to do enhancements to have things stand out on your terminals, but it all depends on what the terminal is capable of. The good news is once you have a standard common set, you know it's going to work no matter what anybody's going to be bringing up. Okay. PS1, this is what tells you where are you located, what are you currently in. The most common thing to do is just put out a pound sign for root and a dollar sign for users. Not very useful. So the first thing you want to do is put PWD. Let's find out where we are. But I had to CD into some Java stuff, and oh my god, I had 17 levels down and the prompt string was 400 characters long. Is there some better way of doing that? Okay. So one of the things I did is I came up with a way of customizing, again, with one single profile. PS1 would be set first off with a tag that indicates what prompt character I'm going to use at the very end. And then I said, I'm going to export, and this double PWD thing, this is an incantation for the shell that says, give me the last and the second to the last directory. Not just the last directory, but the second, the last, and the last. This means if I go to user local bin, instead of just saying bin, it'll say local bin. If I CD then to user contrib bin, it'll say contrib bin. So it gives you more information. Another thing you can do is add in the host name, add in your ID itself, and you can put it in this manner. In this case, I'm using from that previous slide with those enhancements, I'm using a half bright followed by the host name, an underline followed by my ID. So this gives me the ability to show that information much more clearly because it has the enhancements actually attached with the PS1 value. Again, the samples of these are in the handout scripts for profiles and dot profiles. It's important to have the HIS file and HIS size values exported. For HPUX, for most of its life, both the shell, POSIX shell and the K shell did not work that well if you didn't have them defined. You'll get your command history, the ability to do an escape K and get back the information from the previous history, or type in the history command and see it. You'll get it because you have defined it. Now remember I said set minus U is the right thing to do. This command here is going to test to see whether HIST file is set. If it's not set, we're going to assign it this value. That colon minus does that. Well, how can we do that if HIST file is undefined? It should abort. And indeed it would if it wasn't protected with the dollar brace that you see here. In this case it says HIST file is now going to be evaluated. If it doesn't have a value, this construct says assign everything there. So we now have assigned it. Then we also export that and we also get a HIST size. Now I have 9,000 up there. For my production systems, when I worked in the financial industry, I needed to have things from 6 months ago. There were some really important things that I did, and I can't remember what they are. So every 6 months, I would archive my shell history, but I wanted to go back 20,000 lines. So I had HIS size equal to 25,000. Okay. That way then I could do an escape slash and look for all the VG exports that I did, or look for all of the new FSs I did, and I'd be able to see them. Won't be able to tell what time or date that it happened, but at least I can see it in order, and that's the most important. Shell timeouts are kind of important because this allows for your root to walk up to the console and start a tar backup and then leave and never come back again. Not a good idea. The tar backup takes place in an hour, it's finished, and now we leave the console open with a prompt that says, please log in and destroy me. Not a good idea. We want to have that logout disappear, and the way to do that is to set timeout value. For all of the POSIX shells, the TMOUT value will indeed set a timeout, with the caveat that it is for the shell and shell only, which means that if you're running VI, if you're doing something with an application program and you walk away, until the application program stops, VI quits, the shell is sitting there idle. It's not accumulating any time at all. You have to go back to the shell, the timer starts over again, and when you finally have 3,600 seconds in this case, then it will log out automatically. So just be aware that it's not a cure-all for people who log in and don't close their sessions properly, but it's a start. It's really important for root users. I like to have all of my, what I call unhappy commands, commands that can destroy data, I like to have them use the minus I. It's a default in Linux, and this makes it the default in HPUX. I'm simply saying that move and copy and RM, all three of them can destroy data. So I'm going to ask the question, do you really want to remove slash stand slash vmunix? No, that would be a bad thing to do. So it's going to give you one last chance. It's going to give you a mulligan to be able to get over that. Here's a couple of shortcuts. I like to recall the history. And in standard HPUX shells, you'll find that the history has, you can just type in the word history, and it'll show you the last 20 lines. Well, that's nice to have that, but wouldn't it be nicer to just type in H? So I just make H equal to FC minus L, and it gives me that information. I'd just like to be able to type that. I have a command called C, which simply clears the screen. Instead of typing the word clear, it makes it much simpler to do that. So in my C alias here, you'll notice that it says tput khome and then tput clear. What this does, the clear command simply clears the visible screen. Now, for a really truly dumb terminal, VT100 has no memory, so that is all there is. But if you have a smart terminal like this PuTTY, I've got thousands of lines of history up above, they will not be cleared. So if I want this to be cleared, I want to use this particular incantation, and just making that equal to the letter C means I can type in C and I'm ready to go. You see a couple of others, M for more and N for NS lookup and so on. Just quick, easy ways of being able to do things. For LP, I want to replace that. There's a couple ways of handling LP. When we're printing something, the banner page is on by default, so you always get this little separator page at the front of each one of the jobs. You can go in and modify the script, the printer script, and it won't do anything. It'll actually not print that, but that requires knowledge of the script, and then if you replace it, you got to go back in and do it again. Or you can use the option minus ONB, and that will give you no banner. If you alias LP to that, whenever you type in LP, automatically you get that result. You get the banner turned off for everybody, so it makes it a little easier. I have LS and LL aliased, and this allows you to see not only the hidden files. Everybody know what a hidden file is in Unix? Okay, just a few hands. It's a dot file. Not very hidden, but because you can say LS minus A, and you'll see all of those dot files. But unfortunately, it gets into trouble because in many cases you want to look at a directory. You also want to look at the directory that you're in and the parent directory and see what its permissions are, especially when you're doing an LL command. So I will alias both of those. The capital F is optional. Some people like to see this, and that what it will do is identify what type of a file you're looking at. This file might have a slash at the end. That indicates it's a directory. It might have an asterisk at the end, and that indicates that it is an executable. It might have an at symbol, and that indicates it's a symbolic link. I used to use that all the time, and then I got in trouble as I was starting to paste in that line of information, and I'd paste the star into the end of it, and well, that didn't work out as well as I wanted to. So I turned that particular feature off. But again, these are things you can do with aliases. One very powerful tool in HPUX is PS, and it's one that is very, very badly underutilized. How many people have typed in PS-EF pipe to grep? Everybody does it. Because Unix 101 for Dummies says PS-EF pipe to grep. Well, here's the problem is grep doesn't know anything about, let's do a PS and we'll do a minus EF and we'll pipe this to grep. And I'm going to grep for all of the SH processes. I'm running the POSIX shell over here. And by the way, in HPUX, the POSIX shell is SH. The born shell is SH. Clear? Well, no. It turns out that the born shell is hidden away in user old bin. Nobody ever uses it, so it's never shows up. But many years ago, like 25 years ago, HPUX chose to have SH be the POSIX shell. And the born shell, so they have the same name. Nobody's ever going to use the born shell. So just be aware. I'm going to look for all of the born shells so that I can put them into a kill script of some sort. Oh, you know what? That has not worked out well. Because if I kill those things, I'm going to have some problems. I mean, it's okay to kill that. That's me looking for myself. And, well, if I do this, then I'm shutting down my X-Windows desktop server. If I kill this, I'm losing my SSH capability for the system. This is very bad. This is the thing that's handling memory. So really, there's only one copy of the shell running, and it's right down here. And so if I were just to grep and grab the process ID and do a kill, I would have a mess on my hands, okay? Well, it turns out that PS has a capability of finding the exact name itself and not using grep. If we don't use grep, we're not going to confuse a process called bill with billing, because I have a billing cycle. And when I run billing, I don't want to kill everybody that has the word bill in it. It might kill my session, but it's also going to do some damage to the accounting system. This is not good. So I want an exact match. Well, PS knows exactly what the name is. No matter whether it's KSH, BASH, or SH, it's going to find it out. To do that, what we do is, let's do here's a nice little command called type. And I'm going to tell you a type on PS. Okay. Now, you've seen which and where is and those kinds of things. Unfortunately, which and where is, those particular commands do not tell you what the shell is going to do. Which and where is sort of say, this is where things are stored, local normal locations. But if you type in the word for, or in my case, if I type in the word PS, which and where is are going to find where the binary is located, but they're not going to find out this. And this is what the shell knows, and this is what the shell will do. It's actually an alias for Unix 95 equals, and then the actual name of PS. Unix 95 is a special variable. It's seen in a lot of flavors of Unix. And what it does is turns on XPG4 behavior. For PS, this opens up a whole new series of options. And that's great. Some of the options are very powerful. One of them happens to be the minus capital C. So if I say I'm going to look for PS, and I'm looking for a long listing, and I'm looking for just SH, bingo, that's all I get. Because I have said, give me the exact name of SH, and there it is. So this gives me an exact match. Additional options that it turns on, minus capital H for hierarchy. We can get a hierarchical listing of everything that's going on in the system. And let's do it for everybody so we get something a little more interesting. So we see a long listing, and let's scroll up here a little bit, and we can see how things are indented. We see how these things are indented because this is a child of that process and so on. Gives us a nice listing. Gives us an indication of what is attached to other processes. Still another option is minus O. This is kind of roll your own version of the PS command. So I'll say PS minus everything, and I'm going to look for, I want to have the process ID, and I want to have the parent process ID, and I want to look at the virtual size, the size of memory used locally on the process, and then the arguments that are in that Let me get plural here. So now I've created my own PS listing. Process ID, parent process ID, size. Oh, hey, if I have the size, I can sort by size, and now my process list will come out with the biggest memory users at the top. So let's go ahead and insert that in the front to make it easier to sort. And we'll get rid of the extra one here. And then we'll just pipe it into, sort here. Obviously, this keyboard is defective. You probably haven't ever run into that before. Okay, and so I sorted it in reverse order, and so I got all these zeros at the bottom, but then I have all these eights and threes, and you know, it doesn't look like what I want to have. It actually sorts it up so that I have the largest ones at the top. Now, if I put in the minus RN, I can sort the largest ones at the bottom. But what this does is it shows me the top memory users on this particular system. So we have the ability to customize and pick up an option that is not normally available with PS. And that's the VSZ option. Only the XPG4 version of that will have that present. So here's some other shortcuts. I like to search through the history file a lot, just finding things. So I'll use hgrep. By the way, the history file on the POSIX shells is a binary file. You may not have known that, but you would find it out as soon as you decide to edit it. Unfortunately, most of the people who decide to edit are trying to hide their tracks. I didn't mean to put that command in. Let me get rid of it and nobody will know who did it. If you remove a line or add a line or change a line in a history file, then you'll go back and you say, show me the history, and it gives you nothing. And that's because at the beginning and scattered throughout the shell history file are some binary numbers that the shell puts in there. Ooh, that's kind of a nice little security feature. So be aware that if you use the history file, you can't manipulate it. You can only just search it. You can only read it. Also, KSH-93, the Corn Shell 1993 version, is available on our systems. It's hidden. It's in the desktop X Window stuff. That's what user DT is. This is an X Window version of Corn Shell. Actually, fairly useful if you really like X Windows, but it's kind of falling out of favor, mostly because it's so complicated and the security is so bad that it's hardly ever used. But if you need to, there is a Corn Shell 93. The major difference is that Corn Shell 93 offers real numbers. Normal K Shell, Bash, or POSIX Shell all have integers. 1 divided by 2 is 0, period. Whereas 1 divided by 2 in KSH 93 is actually 0.5. And it does indeed work. So you can take this is a quick way to actually specify. Now, I just use KSH-93 as a memory reminder. You can call it whatever you want to. K93, doesn't matter. But that's where Corn Shell 93 is located. Here is a nice feature for setting up a default printer. What is the proper default printer for a server? It's a trick question. Nobody know? No. What's the default? What's the correct default printer for all servers?
None.
There you go. Already, our first prize winner of the day. This is SourceDirect transforming from black to white. And that is, there is no default. The reason there's no default printer is because the one that is sitting next to you is the correct default. But not her, because she wants the other one over there. And I want the color one over there. And I like the one downstairs, because that's where I'm sitting. So we don't want to have a default printer. So never set a default printer on a Unix system, especially if the server has more than one printer. Okay? But you can customize it. LPDest is a reserve word for the LP subsystem. If you set this variable equal to the printer name, then it becomes a default. You just say LP file name, LP file name, and it goes to your printer without any other option. Very cool. But if you put this into the profiles of all the users, when they come up and says, hey, my LP command doesn't work, what does it say? It says LPDest is not set. Oh, I know what the problem is. because there is no printer with that name. I have just simply set the variable, if it's not already defined, I've set the variable equal to that string, and now the help desk will know how to assist you in defining your default printer. One of the things that happens when you're booting up the system is you go through all of these RC scripts, and each one of the RC scripts runs for some length of time, and then it goes on to the next one, and sometimes it runs a long time, but you never know it, because RC.log has no information about when it happened. So what I did, and by the way, I have to go down to the bottom here and say Marlou Everson from the ITRC forums posted this, and this is an incredibly useful tool. You edit this file, rc.utils, and you insert a date stamp. Oh, my VPN went away. Okay, we'll get it back later. And so we're going to add this into that line. The line normally looks like this, a bunch of dashes followed by a double greater than log file. We're going to add it in, put in the date at the end. So each time the RC script runs, it's going to have a timestamp. Very useful tool, okay? And now what you'll have is when you're looking at rc.log, you'll see this information, you see what's happening, the startups occurring, crash dumps, etc. And then you'll see the dashes which separate it, and you'll see now a timestamp. So you can now take a look at each one of the timestamps, and you see this is 5 seconds, 10 seconds, 5 seconds, 200 seconds. Whoa, something happened between here and here for a very long period of time. That was an Oracle startup thing. We got to go in and check and see if we're doing things incorrectly, where you see extremely long setups. A good example is whenever you start at NFS and you haven't got networking going. NFS, when it comes up, tries to do dumb things, even though there's nothing to do. And so it takes an enormous amount of time, sometimes 300 to 700 seconds to time out and finally get going. Good technique. So, time and time zones. Here we are in Arizona with no daylight savings time. So, how do we handle that? Well, how do we handle it around the world? HPUX is somewhat unique in having only one single time inside, and that is GMT, which is obsolete. It's now called UTC for Universal Coordinated Time, or Zulu, which seems to be universal also. That time is all there is. You never need to change HPUX time as long as you have the TZ value set. What TZ does is it defines a rule that is contained in TZ tab, or TZ is set equal to the rule itself. TZ can do either way. TZ tab is a shorthand. It says, here's the rule. The reason the rules are in TZ tab is because it depends what year you're in. See, actually, the United States changed the time change information several years ago. England tried to do it and gave everybody 6 months' notice, and boy, there are an awful lot of unhappy computer people. Australia tried it, and again, politicians got in trouble. Because, you know what? Time zones are not astronomical. They are political. Politicians define the time zones. You notice they don't line up. They do this. They wave around. Out in the middle of the Pacific, you see a time zone, then there's a little circle around an island in the middle. That's Alaska time there. All the rest of this is like a Polynesian time, and then there's Hawaii time, and there's Alaska. What is it? Well, again, it's politically defined. It's not defined by astronomers. Well, the good news is all of those TZ values can be customized, including daylight savings time switches can be customized in TZ tab. I can create my own time zone. My time zone is minus 6 hours, 12 minutes, and 32 seconds east of GMT. Okay? And when I log in, the time will be represented with that formula. And if I do an LL on my files, the files will have a timestamp that is accurate to my local time zone. It matches my watch, as crazy as it sounds. And it works. Someone else logging in from Australia, from Asia, from Seattle, it doesn't matter where, when they log in, they will see their local time because TZ is translating GMT time to what you see. So as long as you have set the TZ value correct, then the date command will be correct. It also can be used when root is setting the date command. When you set root's date command, you want to make sure that TZ is set first, because it might be set to Eastern Standard Time, and you're typing in a time for Mountain Standard Time. That would not be good, so you set it correctly. Once it's done, you're ready to go. Man page, that is man environ, this is where it gives you all the rules of how to customize your TZ value. Okay. Most important, don't change the time on a running system. How many people are running databases? Oracle, Sybase, anything. So you know how important timestamps are. And databases often are linked together with other systems. Okay? So when we start getting involved with all of that, we want to make sure that our time is accurate and has the same time zone values. But if you decide, oh, I'm going to change the time, it's off by 5 minutes. I'll just move it back. Moving time back means that you now have records that have duplicate timestamps on them. It's never supposed to happen. I have timestamps in the past for files that were created in the present. Worse, put it in the future and then bring it back. Put it in the future, now you have files that have times that haven't occurred yet. Databases get very unhappy with these kinds of things. So change your date, or your time of day information only when the system is quiescent, such as when you're booting it up. Okay? And we're going to talk about a way of doing this automatically. So the most important thing is that everybody who logs in can have their own custom time zone. The default for the system is this one in Etsy time zone, a file that's stored in the system, and you get to pick what it contains. If that value contains EST5 to EDT, then everybody who logs in will have that set. But that's okay because your dot profile can override that. As soon as you override it, the time changes. So it's a very simple technique to be able to control all that. Okay. Any questions? My goodness, I'm answering everything. This is incredible. Alrighty. Well, let's talk about how to synchronize everything. How many people are using NTP right now? Okay, well, that's not a bad thing. I usually get about less than 50%, but we're doing better than that. NTP is a mandatory requirement for any data center that has more than a couple of computers, because all the computers need to have the exact same time.
Well, it looks like it's about 1308.
Well, that's okay, but that's not accurate enough. Databases need to be synchronized with each other. If you're doing banking information, when a check is deposited, when a transaction occurs, we're down to the 1 second accuracy. Would you believe we can actually synchronize our HPUX systems to within 128 milliseconds? In fact, any system that has the NTP code on it can be within 128 milliseconds of atomic time. So it's a great, great technique. There are other ways of doing it. You go out and ask another system what's the date, and then you jam it into it. Remember I said it's a bad thing to move time forward and backwards? What happens when you just jam the time in? It may be off by 3 seconds, but you just set the time forward or backwards. Not a good thing to do. NTP does something very unique. What it does, it says we're off by a fraction of a second. I'm going to catch up, but I'm not going to eliminate or add any seconds. There's exactly 86,400 seconds per day. So I'm going to tick off 86,400 seconds, but I'm going to make them a little bit faster or a little bit slower. And in doing so, we still have the right number of seconds, but we have now moved the clock forward or backward to match up with atomic time. And that's what XNTPD does. It's a very, very low protocol. That is, it's a very small message that's sent out. 64 bytes is sent out, 64 bytes comes back, and it uses port 123. It also only does it once every 64 seconds. You can have an NTP server that services thousands of systems. I've got 5,000 systems out here. Well, we'll have them all come into this one server. And even at that rate, you'll only have a few transactions per second, which is nothing in terms of LAN networking. So you have a very, very useful tool. One of the things that happens in many firewalls, Cisco and even some of the Linksys routers and so on now, have the ability to have NTP available to sync the router, but it also has broadcast capability. You can go ask the router, what is the time of day using NTP? And back comes the answer. So now you can have your router pointing to a nice, clean source. Now it's best to have, if you have your systems on the open internet, have multiple sources. If you're a mariner and you go out, Bob and Adam, you know, you're obviously mariners, but if you're a mariner, you don't want to take two clocks with you when you're on the ship. You need a clock in order to tell where you're located, what time is it, and where are the stars at. Unfortunately, when you have two clocks, what time is it? It's only accurate if both clocks are identical. If they're not accurate, and the time is different, which one do you believe? Don't know. So we need to have an odd number, at least three, maybe five different time sources, so we can use that advantage of looking at multiple time sources. NTP can not only do that, it can also tolerate the dropout. If you lose all contact with the outside world, NTP keeps freewheeling. And the way it works is that it has a drift file in there that maintains what is the average drift for this system. Over the last several days, it's drifted about 0.03. So it will keep on drifting at that amount, knowing that unless you change the temperature of the computer room radically, it will probably continue to run the same speed. And then when you get your connection back again, it makes that minor adjustment. NTP is very slow. It takes hours to correct a few seconds. You can get up to as much as 5 minutes in about 3 or 4 hours. If you have more than 10 minutes, NTP will give up and says, sorry, the difference is so large that I will not be able to accomplish that change within 1 day. Remember, we need to have that 86,400 second block there. So it'll stop and says, we've lost sync. We will not be able to resynchronize. So be aware of that when you set that up. Oh, and at the bottom, you notice I have a little bit of note there about Windows-based. If you're in an environment where you have Winds and you have the NTPS, that's the simplified version, the Windows servers tend to be very unstable in terms of NTP time. Now, NTP time is extremely accurate. And Winds says, hey, it could be off a second or two, and it can drift around. It's not a big deal. But for true accuracy, NTP is defeated if you point it to Windows servers. So just be aware of that. So here's how you set it up. First off, I prefer using the NTP pool. Rather than going out and find specific NTP sources, like the University of Arizona most likely has one, I know the University of Georgia has one, Denver's got some, the U.S. Geological Survey has some, and so on. There's just all kinds of them out there. NTP.org is a great place to find them. Well, what's happened is a lot of the NTP server owners, the sysadmins, have gotten together and says, we're going to form a pool, and our machines will take on the load for a period of time. And by using a dynamic DNS, we're going to have this pool.ntp.org, that location, like this is the North America pool, we're going to have several servers, and I can go out there and take a look at them and poll them by using NTPQ. This is the quality. It says, what is the NTP quality of this particular server? You see it's composed of these particular machines. And you see the dispersion on the right-hand side and the offset. This gives a relative idea of how accurate it is. If those numbers on the right, dispersion is in tens of thousands, you're obviously not in sync at all with that server. If the reach value out here is not 377, then we haven't gotten enough measurements to make any sense, or it's drifting too much. So this says that everything looks good. And what we're doing is we're saying to the pool, tell me about your servers. How accurate are you relative to those locations? So you do the same thing on HPUX. We do two steps. We edit the netdaemons file, pick a location. I just use us.pool.ntp.org. That's a shorthand name for North America. And then we set XNTPD equal to 1, and that's about it. And then now, the next time we reboot the machine, what will happen is we will force the time. We'll actually jam the time to the correct value way before anything has started. Right after networking is working, then we start up the NTP software. That's when it's going to go out and get the time of day. So it's not going to damage the system at all because we're changing it long before we've finished booting up. And then in ntp.conf, you're going to find an incredibly long file with every comment in the world. I think they tried to put in every possible connectivity mechanism there was. None of which you care about, because that's in the man page, that's in the documentation at ntp.org. So what I do is I simply erase all that and just put in these values here. So I've got three sets of servers. Each one of these pools will be changing dynamically constantly. The NTP code will figure out what the best time is among all of these, and we'll track them for hours at a time to make sure that it's nice and clean. And then we just make sure we tell it that there is a drift file out there to keep the systems in sync. Make sure the file exists. If it exists, we can continue on running. Then we run XNTPD. Now, notice I didn't say to run the actual start script in sbin init.d/XNTPD start. That's what will happen when the system reboots. But remember I said when we reboot, we're going to jam the time. So we don't want to run the start script while the system is running, because it's going to jam the time. Then take a look at syslog and follow it for a few hours, make sure that the time values are updating correctly. Okay. Any questions about NTP? KSH, there's a couple here. Key shell was something that was started years ago when HP terminals were all there were. And they were fairly useful. You would be able to do things like hit a soft key and it would do an LS command, hit another soft key and it would do a CD up one level and so on. It is basically useless. First off, because most of the terminals that you're going to be using will not be HP. They'll be typically a BT100 lookalike. So in that case, you don't have the labels and therefore key shell doesn't mean anything. So that goes away. Scummy C shell, there's a great website out there that says why I hate C shell. There's also another one that says why I hate C. So way too many ambiguities, difficulties, very complex constructs you have to do that are so simple to do in a standard POSIX shell. There's HP's POSIX shell. It's called a POSIX shell because we want to make sure we understand it's not the Born shell, even though they have the same name. And of course, good old Corn shell. So there's where everything is located. There's the C shell, and there's our why not for that location. Hey, the user can change their own shell. This is good because they're constantly calling up and says, hey, I don't like Corn shell, or I don't like Born shell, or whatever. Well, you can change it yourself. You can type in CHSH, specify your user ID, and whatever you want. Now, this may be followed in a few minutes by someone who tried to log in because they didn't spell it right, and so they are now going to user splat slash sh, and it doesn't work, and so it comes back and says no home, and that's it. So you may end up having to change the shell for them, but if they can spell correctly, most users will do the right thing. If they are asking that kind of question, they're probably a little bit more knowledgeable than a typical end user. There are restricted shells, RKSH, RSH, RCSH, and so on. Those restricted shells are incredibly restricted. They are shrouded shells, which means that they change the environment so that you are now below the slash variable. If you are in your home directory, your slash, your root directory is your home. You can't go up. It's impossible because you are at the highest possible level as far as the shell is concerned. Now, this introduces a lot of things you probably didn't think about. What if I want to type in LS? LS not found. Well, it's in user bin. Yeah, but you don't have user bin. You don't have anything except what's in your home directory. To make LS work, you got to copy all that stuff to their home directory. And then they got to say, oh, by the way, there's some shared libraries. You'll need to make sure that those libraries are also accounted for. Oh, and then there's some Etsy files that you'll probably need copies of. And see, it gets a little nasty trying to make a restricted shell work. My recommendation is the amount of effort needed to make a restricted shell work is much, much bigger job than writing a menu. You just simply write a user menu. It's a simple shell script. They log in, and you can type number one to do this, number two to do this, and whatever else they type, it exits out of the menu, and they have to log in again. Very simple. It eliminates all the calls because, hey, I can't do anything. Yeah. And that's a good thing. Okay, FTP needs Etsy shells. This is the standard set of shells that are available for this particular system. Well, this system is going to be using these sets of shells if it doesn't exist. GetUserShell is the thing that is going to be asking this question. So FTP calls GetUserShell, and it either is in this list, and if it's not, FTP will not let you log in, which is kind of a pain. Didn't used to be that way until we switched over to the Washington University FTP, WFTP. But it's actually a good thing. So this means if you add any shells, like you want to put in bash, for instance, be sure you put in user bin bash into this list so that the FTP user will be able to come in and be accepted. And at the very bottom, for all HPUX systems forever and ever, always, sbinsh is the only shell for root. The reason is the SBIN directory consist of files with all the executables are archived, which means all the libraries they need to run are inside the executable. The reason you need this is when you first boot up, you don't have user, you don't have lib, you don't have any of those locations. Since they don't exist, the shell can't run. So if you change this to K shell and you boot up into single user mode, it says, hey, I can't run K-Shell, and you get no shell, you get stuck. Not a good situation. So always make sure that sbin sh is root shell. Well, I like all the features of bash. Well, if you like it, first off, why are you logging in on the console as the root user? Okay, because bash doesn't give you anything that's going to make maintenance of your system. Remember, when you're in single user mode, you're doing maintenance on the system. In fact, when you're in the console, the only thing you should be doing in the console is maintenance. Not sitting there reading email and looking at a few things and doing general purpose stuff. That is for an ordinary user. Be safe. Always be an ordinary user and only go to root when you need to. So bin sh is perfectly okay. If they really got to do it, they can simply type bash and start using their bash commands. Okay? Of course, if they're in single user, they'll type bash and it says bash not found. That's right. That's why we have that restriction. So we need to make sure that path is set and sourced in etc profile. Sometimes this gets to be a very long line, okay? And you have 4, 5, 6 lines on your screen and you can't tell, gee, is the thing I need inside there? Well, worse off, path can be a big security risk, okay? Dot in your path is really convenient and really a really big restriction or a security restriction. Here's what happens. Hacker Joe comes along and he says, hey, Mrs. Admin, I need to have you come over and mount my CD-ROM for me because you won't give me root privileges. Okay, come over. He says, su-root, password. Sorry. I think I typed it okay. su-root, password. Okay, everything's all right. Mount the CD-ROM. Take off, you're done. Just gave away the root password to the hacker. And the way it was done was real simple. The hacker put dot in the path, put it in his path, his own personal path. So when the system administrator came over, did not log out and start a new shell, but used the root's environment. As a result, there was a script in there called su. But you'd never know that because you didn't say, where am I getting my copy of su? You just typed in su. Normally, you don't have to do that. Well, where's your SU been lately? It's been in hacker heaven. And what it does is it comes out and it says password. And then it turns off echo. And then you type something in. It takes that information, stores it in a file, renames itself, and then exits and says sorry. Now you type it in again. Because it's been renamed, it won't find it in your home directory. It's going to find someplace else. And it'll find the right one. Everything looks okay. But it's too late. Password is gone. Dot is really bad. Now here's a couple of interesting ways that that current working directory can be set up. You can have two colons side by side by accident in the path statement. That is the same as colon dot. You can have a dot on the end by accident. That means current working directory is a valid path. So those each one of those locations is a valid location that says we have dot there. So what I did, and there are other reasons. You need to remove the paths that don't exist anymore or they're not necessary. You need to disallow symbolic links. If we're pointing to something and we don't know what it's pointing to, we don't want it in our path. Put the real path in the path variable. And we certainly don't want world writable directories. If a directory is world writable, it means the contents cannot be trusted. If they can't be trusted, we don't want anybody pulling anything out of it. So we don't want temp and vartemp there. We don't want anybody's home directory there. So we want to make sure path is clean. In the scripts that I have in that CD, one of those is going to have an actual script called a secure path. It's going to scan the path for you and tell you what you currently have. And it's going to check and see symbolic links, world writable directories, anything related to security issues associated with those items. Okay. All righty. Any questions? Okay. Let's talk a little bit about kernel parameters. Kernel parameters are an interesting situation. They were pretty stable for many, many years. But starting with the latest round, 11.23 and now 11.31. How many people are running 11.31 anything yet? One? Two? Just a couple. Okay. 11.23. How many people got 11.23? Yeah, a little more popular. And then everybody else is on 11.0. Any 10.20? Anybody running 10.20 or earlier? Yeah, I got some 10.20s. Okay.
Yeah, you probably got some Windows 95 out there, Drew, right? Some systems will not die. You can't get rid of them. Or most commonly, the application program provider has gone out of business. This is the only copy. It only runs on this, and we have no choice. We got to run it forever. So, okay. That's just what happens. Well, it turns out the kernel parameters are starting to change, so you don't have to reboot every time that you change a kernel parameter. As an example, with 11.23 and 11.31, things like nfile and max d size and dbc max percent and so on, don't need to have them constantly changed or adjusted as you go along because you can do it on the fly. So probably the most important part about kernel tuning is there is no go faster. I've been looking for that parameter for a long time. I want to go faster, but there isn't one. And the reason is that the system is running as fast as it can. The kernel parameters are primarily designed to tune certain features. Turn on a particular setting, set a fence, which is very common. I don't want you to go above. We have lots and lots of RAM, but I don't want any user using more than this much. So we're going to limit the amount of RAM they have. Or I have a dynamic buffer cache, but I don't want it to get any bigger than this. But I want to have a minimum amount. So we want to specify those values. Okay? In many cases, it's going to also specify the maximum number of things, such as the number of files or the number of processes and so on. We would like to be able to change the CPU speed, but we can't. And in many cases, I say, well, we only got one CPU. If I add 10 more CPUs, then this one program I've got could run 10 times faster, right? The analogy is that if you have a woman and she's going to have a baby, it takes 9 months. Therefore, 9 women working really hard can have a baby in 1 month. No, it doesn't work that way. It basically says that if you're going to take advantage of multiple processors, you better have something separate for them to do because they can't be working on the same problem at the same time. They can work on different parts, but that's what is called threading. We're taking and creating little sub-programs that can be put on another processor, and they run all by themselves until they're done, and then they resynchronize themselves back into the main program. A good example of a multi-threaded program is a browser. There's Internet Explorer, there's Firefox, there's Mozilla, there's Opera. Each one of those, you'll notice that while you're looking at something and it's filling in the page, you can go and pull down a menu and you can go someplace else, you can cancel what it's doing and so on. And it seems very seamless, but the reality is there are multiple things going on at the same time. If you have a multi-CPU, part of it's running on one system and part of it's running on another CPU. That's really pretty cool, but that's what a multi-threaded operation is. So, let's talk about the most popular parameter that needs to be changed is nfile. It all, just like disk space, it continues to grow and get bigger and bigger as your applications do. So, every single open file and network connection is counted. So if you have just a few open files, but you've got 10,000 network connections, you're going to need to have nfile much larger than 10,000 in order to accommodate that. You'll get a message in syslog. It'll say file table is full. And in 11.31, it's now deprecated. That's a fancy Unix term that says, don't use it anymore, we don't need it. And that's nice because nfile is one of those where you have to monitor a system that is continuing to expand. I've added more users, I've added new processes, we've upgraded the software, so on. You do that on the right-hand side, it says sar minus v space 1. And what that looks like, and we'll have to do two things here. First off, we have to get ourselves a VPN connection because it just disappeared. Come on, you can do it. I know you're not connected. Give me a login. Are we not connected to the internet anymore? Let's find out. We may not be connected anymore. No, we're not connected anymore. I know what happened. My 24-hour logon has expired. Okay, well, we'll fix that in a little bit. Okay. All right, so sar minus v will give us that information. And what it's going to do is it's going to show two columns of interest. One is going to be a file count, and the second one is going to be a process count. It's going to tell us what the current value is slash maximum value. When things get close to 60, 70, 80% for sure, you need to start looking for a time to be able to change it. For older systems, 1020, 11.0, 11.11, and so on, you'll need to make sure you have time to be able to reboot, because this is a fixed table inside the kernel. It has to be rebuilt in order to make it bigger so you can accommodate more files. Okay? NFLOX is one of those parameters that it's hard to predict what the value is. The value may be 100, it may be 200. Then you add another application, or the application is now taking on a new feature. It's the number of files that need to be locked at the same time. This may be impossible to determine without the vendor's help. Tell me how your program works and how many files you're going to need, because otherwise you'll have to set it to some ridiculously large value to make it continue to work forever. NINode is always going to be full. It technically is a list of all of the unique HFS file system inodes. It's not the same as the inode on the disk. It's an in-core cache of inodes. It's used to speed up the process of saying, I want to open a file, I want to open a file again, I want to open it up again. Instead of having to go through the whole directory process, we know where it's located. We've got that inode in memory, so we pull it out of that memory. But unfortunately, there are some other features that it goes through. The value is essentially not used very much anymore, especially starting with 11.0 and 11.11. The simplest value to set it to is somewhere between 1,000 and 8,000. I usually set it to 4K and just leave it. It will look like it's full, but it will be always reused because it doesn't indicate the number of unique values. It indicates all the values it's got. And then as a value is, it runs out of space, it'll say, is there anybody else I can get rid of? Well, this is not open anymore, so it can go and reuse that slot. So they will be reused automatically. But unfortunately, the metric doesn't tell you how many are permanent and need to be retained and how many are temporary and can be replaced. There will be a formula in, if you haven't changed it, there will be a large formula in there. Wipe out the formula completely and just put in a single value. The formulas are not very accurate. You use the formula and it gives you a number that's usually way too big and it doesn't match your system. Now, max files and max files limit are really useful in that they can control the amount of files that a single user process can open at a time. This is good because you can control the runaway process. I've got a programmer out there, he's kind of young, just doing a bunch of things, trying some recursion and so on, and now he's got 10,000 files open. If you have n files set to 10,000 and you open up every single one of them in some dummy program, not even root can log in. If you don't have a window open, you can't fix the problem. If you can't tell the user, stop doing what you're doing, if you can't find them, if you can't get things cleared up enough to be able to stop this runaway process, the system will essentially be locked up. It'll constantly get all sorts of errors as other processes try to open files. But unfortunately, you can't log in, because what do you need? You need to have a Getty. You need to have something that gets you a login prompt. You need to have a connection to Etsy profile, and so on. All of these require file opens. Don't have that. So to prevent that, you set max files equal to the maximum number of files that a single process can open at one time. Seems reasonable. And you have a max files lim, which is designed for special processes that need thousands of files opened. So you set max files equal to 200 and max files lim equal to 4,000. Life is good. Everything's great. Until you call up somebody like Oracle or Sybase and they will say, set both of them equal to each other and set it up to 4K or 8K or some value. Well, what they did is they just destroyed the whole purpose of having two values. Here's your soft limit for normal users. Here's your hard limit for the biggest possible process we ever want. And they just made them equal, so therefore this doesn't have any meaning anymore. Well, wait a minute. They're not managing my system. I am. Since I'm managing the system, I need to make the rules. Okay, so you set max files again to a value that makes sense. With processes such as Oracle, you have a system call. Set our limit. You can actually call that library routine and specify a larger value inside the program. So you don't even care what max files is set to. You set it to the value that you need. If you can't get it, then of course you get an error condition and it'll give you a nice meaningful error message. The value for set our limit was this, and the system limit is that, and therefore I will not be able to continue. You ever seen a message like that? Me either. The programmer knew what it was, but didn't put it out. Instead it says Aura 47329, and it says system parameter is out of range. What does that mean? Well, it's for them to know and me to guess. So, okay. So don't make max files equal to max files lim. NPROC. Need to make NPROC large enough to handle all the processes at one time. Again, the same problem. We're trying to prevent a runaway. The worm way back in the last century now that went around and just started spawning processes over and over and over again. Would do it because there was no limit on the number of processes. It was simply recursive. So you keep doing it until it fill up the process table. Some systems would just say, okay, that's fine, and it would just kind of idle there until it was done. Then you'd reboot the system, everything would be fine. Others, it would actually crash the system, which is not good. So you set this value. Usually it's going to be too low. You probably need it in the 5,000 to 10,000 range. How far can you go? Hundreds of thousands is fine, although with the earlier versions of HPUX, you're limited to a process ID number of only 32,000, and then it went up to 65,000. So you don't want to set it to an outrageous number. It'll be self-terminating if you set it up to 100,000 and the system can't reach it. Still not going to be able to assign that many processes, but that is the message that you'll see in syslog, proc table is full. And finally, max uproc, this is to prevent a single user from using all the processes up. Again, the runaway. We can simply say to this user, every user in the system is limited to 50 processes. Okay. Well, this is every process in the system that has this user ID, whether they logged in or not. If you logged in 3 times, if you logged in 100 times, every process that you have is counted as one. Okay, that seems like a reasonable thing. Oh, you know what? We got a user out there called Oracle, and it's running a whole lot more processes than most of us do. So if I set Oracle's limit to 50, that may not work. I may have to set it larger. So in this case, you're going to find system or application user logins are going to have a much larger value. It can only be set globally for the whole computer, so therefore you have to pick the largest value. So you may still have to make it 400 or 500. But that's just to be aware of that. Max D size and D size 64. This is the size that a process can occupy. This size here is how big a process local memory. It's also called heap memory if you're talking in C language. And that heap area is the size of data that it can get. The way that 32-bit programs are mapped, they have 4 sets of 1 gigabyte maps. Okay? And the gigabyte maps look something like this. And they're called quadrants for, well, I guess it's because there's 4 of them. So here's our data area. That's our data segment. And each one of these are 1 gigabyte. So we can go up to as much as 900 megabytes, 0.9 gigabytes of data in the data area with a standard executable right out of the box, no special options. With one special option, we have the ability to make that bigger. We can actually take over the next quadrant. This is quadrant 2, this is quadrant 1, 3, and 4. Quadrant 1 is actually our text area, which is a fancy name for the instructions that the program uses. Now, these are the instructions that never change. It doesn't have any data in it. These are instructions that never change. This area here is actually shareable. We can have multiple copies of VI using one text map because none of the instructions inside VI change. Only the data area for each user will change for that copy of VI. So since this is going to be very small, this is a gigabyte of actual text is going to require this much printout to show you the compiled program because it's going to have millions and millions of lines of code in it. Whew, that's a lot of code. Most programs are not that big, so the text area is pretty small. The rest of it's empty. We could remap into that area, and that's exactly what an exec magic option is in the loader. or compiler when you compile your program. You can set that exec magic option. It will now take these two quadrants and hook them together, and you can now get, in a 32-bit program, you can get almost 2 gigabytes of space. It's usually about 1.8 or 1.9. So that's pretty cool. You could also, with additional restrictions and additional capabilities, use the chatter command, chtr, and be able to couple all three quadrants together and get 2.7 to 2.8 gigabytes of space in a 32-bit program. And if you're really looking for memory, you can get almost 3.8 gigabytes by doing, again, another chatter command to get all four quadrants. This is the stack area. Again, the stack is hardly ever used. A normal stack operation has a few megabytes of space, and that's it. The rest of it is unused. And this is the I/O area here. So all of these can be combined in a 32-bit process to give you about this much space. This is the standard way that HPUX maps. Starting with 11.23, there is also an MPAS model that essentially gives you all of these tied together in one. When you compile your program using that option for 11.23 and 11.31, that 132-bit program gets all four quadrants at one time. It changes the whole way that everything is mapped so that these arbitrary limits don't exist anymore, which is kind of cool. If you run out of space at that point, there's only one choice. You recompile the program in 64 bits, fix all your data alignment issues, depending on how well you wrote the program, and now you have terabytes of memory addressable. You'll run out of money long before you'll be able to run out of RAM. Okay, so you'll be able to use the space, but it will be indeed one giant location. Now, max D size, you can change the limit. U limit minus D allows you to change it to a different value. So you could set that value to a large value, but as people log in, you can set it to a lower value for ordinary users. Again, one of the nice features of .profile, or of Etsy profile. .profile, you can go and change it back again if you make it a soft limit. And again, the max D size 64, this is only for 64-bit programs. Very important. Max D size 64 must be larger than max D size. If you set max D size to 10 gigabytes and set this equal to 5 gigabytes, both values will assume 5 gigabytes. So this number, it must be larger, okay, or else it becomes the limiting value. Stack size and T size, we talked about those because these two here are very seldom used. They have very small amounts. If for some reason you get a stack overflow and you need a stack size of 400 megabytes, you'll want to talk to the programmer. They are not passing addresses on the stack, they're passing data. In the old Fortran technique, you said, I'm going to pass by value rather than by reference. A reference says, here's my area here, this is all my arrays and things, I'm going to pass the address and then you'll have it. There's my common area. If they don't do that, send them back to programming school. Swap chunks. That goes away in 11.23. This is how big you can make your swap area. In the old days, we really didn't have to worry about it because we talked in terms of hundreds of megabytes of RAM and maybe a few gigabytes of swap. Now we're talking about 100 gigabytes of RAM and several hundred gigabytes of swap. And that's going to be a really big problem because max swap chunks is only going to give us about 4 gigabytes by default with the normal value. Now, how do you calculate it? Well, this is the way it works. So the maximum swap chunks is swap chunk times max D size. Well, if you go through the whole formula and simplify it down, the desired amount of swap that you want to use, specified in megabytes, divided by 2, and that becomes the new max swap chunks value. That's how you figure it out. Makes it much easier, okay? You do want to have swap large enough to be able to be reserved for all the processes, and we're going to talk about that in just a little bit. Also, you have two places you can put swap. You can put it onto a device, or you can put it onto a file system. File system swap is a little tricky, first off, because it has a lot more overhead than a device does. And secondly, it's essentially a hidden file that occupies space. So once you reserve that space on that file system, it doesn't go away until you reboot. So you have to actually re-specify that again. The only time I would ever recommend using it is, let's say we have some end of month or end of year processing, and we have to have at least 3 times more processes in memory than we normally have swap space to handle it. So we're going to grab some device swap or some file system swap for a little while, and as soon as we've got it, then it'll go away when we reboot. Okay, so be aware that that is a feature. This is the number of individuals. And by default, I believe this is 10, and I think this is like 5. Those numbers seem reasonable enough, and we'll talk a little bit of how that actually works. Finally, we don't talk about DBC min. DBC min and max are the parameters that are probably the most commonly misconfigured in all of HPUX, starting version, I believe, 9, but for sure 10 and higher. The max DBC is dynamic buffer cache. It is the space where files, that is individual files, data files, are cached so that you can go out and reread the information without having to go to the disk. You remember what it used to be. The first time it takes a little while to read it, the second time it's instant. Second time it's instant, third time it's instant. Over and over again, we can repeat. So this is a real cool tool, and it really speeds up operations. Okay? DBC max percent is 50%. If it's in 50% on your system, it's too large, because technically it could grow to occupy that much space. Now, if your system's not doing anything, who cares? It's all right. But it also shrinks very slowly. The idea is that DBC is going to go down, down, down as you need more processes running. But it's very slow, and it could take minutes to make the adjustment. Because it takes so long, that's a bad thing. So we want to get this value much closer to what is reasonable. For 11.0 and 10.20 and 11.11, you're going to need numbers in the range of 1 gigabyte to maybe 2, maybe 3 gigabytes, and that's it. Anything larger, and we're going to get a kind of a diminishing returns, where the bigger we make it, the less effective it is. So this is how much of a performance benefit, and this is how big it is. So we have 1, 2, 4, 8 gigabytes in size. And so it kind of goes like this. And then as you continue on increasing, you don't see any significant increase in performance. So our performance gain here begins to level off. Actually, at 11.0, it actually does this. It goes down when it's extremely large, because it's got to search so many headers for so long, it's going to increase the amount of CPU time taken by the kernel. So the idea is set them to these particular values. 1123, you can go up to about 6. 1131, it's gone. Oh, nice. We now have a file cache max and a file cache lim to control those values. Okay. Any questions?
When it comes to Oracle,
look at how this swap space works. Okay. One might assume that swap space is just an overflow. Once I run out of memory, it throws things into swap, and then when it doesn't need that anymore, it can bring that stuff back and so on. It's a pretty simple way to do it. In HPUX, we have a much different way of handling it. First off, over on the right-hand side, it says obsolete 1131. All of these things are completely gone. So 1131, users can ignore all this. This is historical. But I think most of you have older systems, and this does apply. So here is our 1 gigabyte of RAM. The yellow portion is 500 megs that is not usable, because when this kernel parameter, swap mem on, is off or zero, then this portion here is not mapped in swap, therefore it's not usable by processes. We can throw shared memory in here, we can show shared libraries and SGA and things like that can go in here, but we can't put processes here because there's no place to put them. The goal in the original HPUX and many Linux systems or original Unix systems was that I must have a one-to-one map here just in case I need to use it. I don't want to go out and look for a swap space. I want to have it ready to go. So as soon as you start the process, it reserves some. You increase the process size, it reserves more. So it grows with the application. Again, with the idea that if I need to, I can shove it out into swap space and out of memory, and we'll be able to run. So here's an example where you don't have enough swap space and all the process memory won't run. Now we can run everything. There's our gigabyte of RAM, a gigabyte of swap. Everything's cool, except you'll notice one thing. There will never be any swapping. I can't run any more than 1 gigabyte. because I don't have any more than 1 gigabyte of swap. So therefore, everything has to fit in this amount of memory. So this is kind of like a wasted space. Again, swap mem on. Let's increase it now so we can actually run with a bigger swap area. Now I have 1 gigabyte of RAM. I can run 2 gigabytes of processes, one of which is going to be out here. Some of the processes wouldn't fit. They're idle. They're interactive. Nobody's there. We can leave those in that swap area and bring them back at a later time. The way it works is the kernel says, you know, this is, process hasn't been touched for a while. Another process needs to run. I'm going to swap it out here, and it's just going to wait. Now, as soon as this somebody wakes up and hits a key, aha, need to bring this process back. Take an idle one out of here, move it to here, move this one back. Does that take a long time? Do this. A very long time, especially if it is a large process. We may be swapping many, many, many pages. And those many pages also require spin locks. A spin lock is a very, it's a kernel-intensive process that simply says I got 8 processors out there, one of which is the Monarch processor that's in charge of everything. As soon as I start doing swap or rearranging memory, which is what we're doing, rearranging memory can only be done by one processor. If everybody starts rearranging memory, it's a big mess. So the spin lock is generated by the Monarch and says, hold everything. I got things to do down here. Don't touch it. You can continue on running your local user process, but if it needs to go in and add more memory or give more memory away or start a new process, it'll stop. It'll say, sorry, you can't do anything. Now, spin locks normally take a few milliseconds, so everything's cool. But if it takes a second or 2 seconds or 3 seconds, all 8 processors have essentially ground to a halt when it comes to changing the contents of memory. That's not a good thing. So swapping is a very, very intense overhead that you don't want to have happen. Now, many years ago, we used to have memory measured in hundreds of megs, 128K, 100 or 512K of memory. That's it, just a few megabytes of memory. That's not very much. In which case, we had to have swap, and therefore we had to have swap spaced out, we had to have it interleaved with priorities, we had to have high-speed devices in order to make swap as fast as possible. Today, we can't afford that. We need to have all the processing power we've got. So swap, in this case, is just in case. Now, in this case, we see that we can run 2 gigabytes of processes. We're going to turn swap mem on. We're going to set it equal to a 1. So here's our 1 gigabyte of stuff. And then here is 1,750 megs of space that we can use without any additional swap space. We don't need to have a one-to-one map anymore. Up to 75% of the processes in memory don't need to have a corresponding swap area. Well, that's good. That's kind of neat. Now, it does end up kind of on an edge here, because if you really need to swap something and the process here could be swapped out, it won't be, even though it's idle. So there is a risk that if you have an interactive process, it's not going to go out. So in this case here, you continue on increasing the swap area. Now, the whole concept of swap mem on all disappears at 1131, and for good reason, because it is complex to manage. So for purposes of sizing your systems, the best thing to do is to use the swap info command. Take a look at the very last option in the very last line, swap info. And this is all lowercase, of course, minus TAM. That's TAM. That's the total amount of memory local, and it's going to be measured in megabytes. Okay. And that last line is going to tell you what the virtual memory looks like. If it's reaching 80%, it means that the combination of swap and RAM is 80%. That means you're getting pretty close to the top. It probably also means that you are actually swapping out. And when you swap out, things are going to slow down. So swapping is not a desirable feature, but if you have RAM and swap 1-to-1 or swap spaces 2-to-1 over the size of RAM, you should be okay. 5-to-1 is a waste of space. Okay. A couple other parameters, NPTY. There's actually 3 parameters, and these 3 parameters go together. They're how you get into the system. And as you get into the system, you're going to need a PTY for each one. Well, then they decided, you know, that's not as good as a streams version of the PTY. So a different driver is created and a different device file is created. And same thing for Telnet. depending on which version of 11.0, 10.20, 11.31, and so on, different subsystems are going to use different versions. Okay? The simplest answer is to match all of them and make sure that MPTY equals NStreams and Streams Telnet. All three, make them equal. So if you need 500, make them all equal to 500. I always make the change with SAM or with SMH if you're on the newer version of 11.23 or 11.31. And SAM will do the right thing because although it can create this new value in the kernel, it's not going to create the device files that go with it because there's two parts to it. Kernel parameter, which is the upper limit, and then the device files, which you must have in order to take advantage of that. So make them all equal to each other. And if you want to, you can make this command manually and then rebuild the kernel. But I prefer using SAM because it does everything for you and then reboots. This is a reboot. Okay, just be aware of that. And finally, our last parameter is not a parameter at all. Max users is actually a dummy. And it's thrown into many of the locations in SAM that says this is the kernel value, and it's this max users times 3 divided by the phase of the moon and so on. It doesn't mean anything because what they did is they said, on average, all users need 5 processes and 25 files. Who said? I don't know. I don't think he works at HP. I think he retired a long time ago. Nobody can remember why. The numbers never had a rational value. And if you think about it, an Apache web server is very different than an Oracle database server, which is very different than a Sybase raw device system, which is very different than an interactive process to answer questions and so on. There's all sorts of ways of setting up the parameters. The parameters need to match the environment. So where you see a requirement for an increased parameter count, you need to make the change at that time, rather than simply saying, oh, I'm going to change max users, I'll make it bigger, because it makes a whole bunch of other things bigger that you may not need. We'll take a look at